And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Hello, viewers of Grace of God for All Nations telecast. Gofan Church, the Gospel of Jesus. We welcome you once again to our telecast for today. And with me here is my wife, Pastor Mrs. Loma Ikechi. What do you say to the viewers?
Viewers, you're welcome.
Today we want to present to you what we titled as Led by the Holy Spirit, The Power of Love and Forgiveness. Love is very vital in our society, in communities, in families, home, school, wherever we find ourselves, we need to operate in love and forgiveness. It makes things easier. So I will invite my wife to tell the viewers what God has laid in her heart through the scriptures to tell us about love. Please, what do you have to say to the viewers?
Thank you, man of God. Viewers, we don't speak on our own. We speak through the word of God. If you don't mind, please, if you are with your Bible there, follow me to the book of Mark, chapter 11, verse 25, please. And I read. And when ye stand praying, forgive. If you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. The Bible is telling us here that God will expect me and you, children of God, to forgive one another. God expects me and you to forgive whatsoever somebody has done to you. If you don't forgive, the Bible is saying God, who is our Heavenly Father, will not forgive you. And my sister, my brother, may I remind you, as we live in this world, you will not expect that you will live throughout without somebody doing you wrong one day. In your office, at home, in the church, so many places. But what is it the Bible is telling us? Forgive one another so that our Heavenly Father may forgive you. Thank you. And Pastor, all over the world today, many testimonies we hear, how people got healed, so many things happen in their life, breakthrough, through the power of forgiveness and love. Please, tell us more about this forgiveness and love.
Yes, my dear, as you see, as you read from that scripture, Mark 11:25, the master of love, Jesus himself, who came to redeem us out of the love of God, is one that spoke to us and said, if we are even praying, whether in our house or anywhere, I remember that we are in enmity with somebody, so we should stop, reconcile. So other than that, our Father in heaven will not forgive us. That has been a barrier to many Christians who have done almost everything right in their Christian lives. They give money to church, they give to charity, they help people, they entertain you in your house. They never miss church service. They love God from the things you see they do. But unfortunately, like she said, we have cases where this unforgiveness was not practiced. We do take it for granted. When we read the Bible, we think it's just written there. But we've come to realize that everything written in the Bible is real and it holds. If you don't follow it, surprisingly, you find out Somebody might do everything right and lose his or her soul. Like you said, we have example. That woman, for instance, when we were doing Bible study that day when we just started, when we were praying, Holy Spirit, through the word of knowledge, spoke to me and said, there's a woman in our midst that needs to forgive. And she burst out crying. And we stopped and said, why are you crying? She said, I'm the one. That's okay. You have to forgive. God has spoken right now because he sees that's the burden, that's the problem. And we didn't know this woman was sick because of unforgiveness. The sickness has not gone away. We prayed for her for grace, and she said it was her ex. You understand what I mean? Many of you today may be your ex-husband, ex-wife, or even girlfriend or boyfriend who you shouldn't even bother about, because boyfriend and girlfriend is living a life of sin. And when they leave them, they hold unforgiveness in their heart when they should be rejoicing that somebody who is making them sin is gone out of their life. And then this woman went to summon courage and picked her phone and called the ex. Sometimes people offend you, they say they didn't do you anything. And that was the case. She called the man and said, look, I've forgiven you. I had the gospel today in Bible study, and the God spoke. And I know it was me. That you did to me. The man said, okay, I don't know what I've done wrong, but okay, I accept it. There and then, the woman came and testified. Immediately from her heart, she forgave her ex. She was vomiting her sickness right in her house, in her home. She didn't need anybody to lay hands on her or tell her to fast. Jesus Christ himself saw her heart now is pure with forgiveness and love. Healed her immediately, and she was made whole without my praying. Unforgiveness might be the reason why that cancer, God forbid, has not gone. We see it all the time. Unforgiveness might be the reason why that diabetes has defied solution. So you have to forgive. That's one example. As we go on, I'll talk more on that.
Yes, if I may go further. Man of God, in the book of 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 to 8, if I may read. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. So, Christians, you may not even be Christian, but hearing us today will bring a change in your life.
Amen.
God is telling us that we ought to forgive one another. Amen. God is telling us that he is love. Amen. And if you are a child of God, you must love one another.
In Jesus' name.
You must forgive one another.
In the name of Jesus.
God is telling us that he that is love is of God.
Yes.
If you don't show love to one another, you are not of God.
Uh-huh.
If you don't forgive one another, you are not of God. God will tell you on that day, I do not know you. Now is the time, now is the opportunity. I am encouraging every one of us, show love, love one another, practice love wherever you go, wherever you find yourself. In our homes, there are little things we do, and we tend to overlook them, thinking that they don't matter. They do. That thing you will do to your wife that make your wife to be angry the whole day, that you will do to your husband that will make your husband to be angry for the whole day, even to your children, your friends, your neighbor. If you don't learn to forgive them when they wrong you, your heavenly Father will not forgive you. You are not of God.
That's what the Bible says.
In your workplace, the manager, your co-worker may offend you,
yes,
may not understand you at one point. Mm. You are the Christian who ought to show them exemplary.
In the name of
as
Jesus.
A child of God, you ought to show them love. You ought to let them know, understand that you are a child of God.
Mm.
There must be something different in you. Mm. There must be something that brings others close to you.
Yes.
The love of Christ brings people close to you, wherever you are. Even even if you are a student, you are in school, anywhere you are.
Mm.
If you are that person, nobody likes to come close to you. If you are that person that is always arguing with people, if you are that person that people don't trust, the love of Christ is not in you. You need to change. You need to change and come to Christ. You may be answering a Christian for so much, for a very long time. But you find out that you keep falling short of this love of Christ. You find out that you find it difficult to forgive. What happened this week, you're still remembering it till next month. It's not of God. Come out of it. Go on your knees and ask God to forgive you. He will. You'll begin to live a new life. If I may ask a question today, Pastor, what are the expectations as a child of God in this area of love and forgiveness?
Everything we do as Christians, Jesus stated this quite well in the Bible. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God sacrificed Jesus Christ for the entire world. And Jesus shed his blood very painfully to forgive us our sins. 1 Corinthians 15:1-3 stated it there, that I preach unto you that which I also declare unto you, that Christ was crucified, buried, and raised again for our sins. So one of the things is what Jesus said, one of the expectations, Jesus said it in the book of Matthew 18. If somebody want to go with me there, from 21-22, and Jesus said, then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till 7 times? You see, man in his nature, he was ready to, you know, after 7 times, beat the person or fight back or curse him back or hate him. He was just waiting for you to offend him only 7 times. He forgives 7 times. And then the 8th one, you get it. Jesus says, I have not said 7 times. Jesus said, I say not unto thee until 7 times, but until 70 times 7. Jesus says we should forgive 70 times 7 times. So one of the expectations of a Christian operating in the love of Christ, for example, in my typical nature as a human being, immediately you do me something wrong, I will go after you to show that I'm a human being to treat. But after coming to Christ and I want to make heaven, I begin to live by the principle of the gospel. So Jesus says, for example, you are my wife now, I live with you, you done me wrong, I don't like you. Jesus said, I should forgive you. Let the love continue. Mm-hmm. Before you know it, but God forbid, I know you are not doing such a thing every time. No. God has given us love. And we have loved each other for a long time now, that we don't even keep malice with each other so that they don't get us wrong. But for if any reason, for example, I come home, you have done something I don't like. Jesus said, forgive her. If I done something you don't like, forgive me. And he said 70 times 7 times. When you times that, it's 490 times. How can somebody offend you 490 times, even in your year? So that shows one of the expectations of a believer like you ask is keep forgiving. Keep forgiving. Keep showing love. When you humble yourself, it doesn't matter what the person does for you. Maybe in the church, maybe at home, as she said, anywhere. You build the spirit of just letting go for your own salvation. Because if God looks into your heart, you are bitter against that person and you die. He said, go away from me, you worker of iniquity. You are bitter against Sister Angelina. You are bitter against Sister Margaret. You are bitter against Brother Kay. You are bitter against Brother Richard. He will tell you that and he will surprise you. You live all your Christian life, just one principle of Christianity. And this is what is making many of us lose our salvation. That's one of the expectations of somebody who operates in love. Forgiveness. You can't do without it. And I want to let everyone hearing my voice, you can't do without forgiving people. If you want to make heaven, check it after you have heard this gospel. Who has wronged you have not forgiven. Be consciously, do anything conscious to make sure you are forgiven and God has in your heart that you are forgiven. And you'll be blessed in Jesus' name.
Yes, when you forgive, you say that the outcome of forgiveness to the person who offend and the person who forgave, you say that there will be peace. Peace will reign in them. Peace will reign in their hearts. And Bible encouraged us in the book of Hebrews 12:14. It said, follow peace with all men and holiness without which nobody can see the kingdom of heaven. So my brother, my sister, follow peace. One way of following peace is forgiving one another. One way of making peace in your home is forgiving that person that wronged you at home. One way of making peace is making sure that wherever you are, let me explain this. I've always said to people, it's not from the Bible, but I've always said to people, on that last day, God will not ask you who offended who. God will ask you, yes, he or she offended you, but what did you do after offending you? That's what God is looking at. He said, forgive. They will wrong you. It doesn't matter.
It's even in the Bible. He said, look, what you said is even in the Bible. That place you read, Mark 11:25, that's what he said. He said, if you are praying and remember that you have disagreement with somebody, he said, you go.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
That's what you're explaining.
Amen.
He said, you leave it and go to the person. The person has really wronged you.
Amen.
That's why I go to even people who say, pastor has done them this, or people want to run away from church, from excuse, for their own salvation. You
Amen.
Go back and say, what is the problem?
Amen.
And they explain. The moment you tell them it's okay, you see, they have peace. And you restore them. Sometimes you have nothing to do with their problem, but you realize that they are calling your name into the problem. The Bible says, go and see them and see what is their problem. They are holding you in bondage in their heart. When you say, okay, enough, I forgive you, forgive me, they have the peace. That's exactly what you're saying.
Amen. And moreover, if I may tell the whole world, remind you once again, the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs 10:12, mm-hmm. It says hatred stirs up strife,
mm-hmm.
but love covereth all sin.
Mm-hmm.
If you love one another, hatred will not be wherever you are.
Yes.
You are the one to practice it first. Mm-hmm. One problem I identify in most Christians today is they are looking onto the person, their neighbor, their husband, their wife, their friend. You are the one who wronged me. You are the one to come and ask for forgiveness. No. He said, forget it. Go, reconcile. Love one another. If I love you, no matter how many times you wrong me, mm. I will be able to forgive you.
Mm-hmm.
Forgiveness brings peace, it brings joy.
Yes.
Anywhere you are,
Every person. Environment
you find yourself.
Mm.
And many people find it difficult. Pride will not let many Christians today to come low to go and ask for forgiveness.
Mm.
Some will find it difficult to open their mouth to say, I'm sorry.
Yes.
That word, I'm sorry, is more than any medicine or therapy the doctors will give you. That word, I'm sorry, say it out. Don't feel big about it. God is hearing you. It's about your own personal race. Don't mind what the next person is saying. Don't mind how it's going to look like. Many a times I've gone to people asking them, I'm sorry, telling them I'm sorry if you think I've wronged you. And you say, peace reign. Amen?
Amen.
1 John chapter 4, verse 9. The Bible also is telling us, I'll read it out. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him, live through Christ. If you are a child of God living through Christ, you will be Christ-like. The fruits of the Spirit, of the Holy Spirit of Christ, will dwell in you. And that's fruit of the Holy Spirit in you is peace, forgiveness, love. If they are not there, my sister, my brother, you're on the right track. Come back home. That is why the gospel of Jesus is there for you, to remind you of all these things. Come back. Let the fruit of be Christ-like. Walk in the way of Christ. Throughout the gospel, the Bible, there's nowhere Bible recorded that Jesus was in enmity with people and never forgave. Be a child of God. Let the fruit of the Spirit be seen in you. Let people come to you. The Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 5, someone on the mountain said, you are the light of the world. You are the light. You can never be hidden wherever you are. You are the salt of the earth. If the salt lose its savour, how can its saltness be restored? Let that quality be seen in you. Let that good life be seen in you. Anywhere you are, love one another. Share love. There are many ways you can share love. There are many ways you can show love. Man of God, if you don't mind, please, tell us some of the ways. the practical ways of sharing love.
Yes, love is very, very essential, you see. And if you can't practice love, what we're saying here is it may stand against you. You can't be in Christianity. You can't be a born again and refuse to love. You cannot. They don't work together that you're a Christian and you can't love. How? As I'm speaking right now, you are listening to me. Even if you're not a Christian, you're expected to operate in love. But the true love that we have as human beings can only come when we receive the love of Christ. That's a love that is real. Not filial love. You can give somebody something. You don't love the person. But when you come to real Christ, you see this love will so permeate into your body that anybody who sees you, they will speak by them, say that this man, this woman really operates in love. Because maybe they have wronged you and they saw the way you took it. And you never bothered. And you still continue the relationship with them. For example, as she said, practical way. If you're in a church, and right now I'm talking about church, where all of us gather as children of God in the kingdom of God, and people beside you, three or four, you're not talking to them. What is the reason? You see somebody else, you point to them, you insinuate somebody against them. What is the reason? If you're the one now, every strife in the church is traced through you. You insinuate people against a sister, a brother, man of God. You want there to be commotion. You enjoy that. What is coming is strife, not love. Out of you, hatred. So if there is no love, it is hatred. And that is one thing we want to establish today, that single factor is what the devil is using to catch up with many, many Christians all over the world who has done every other thing right, in quote. But what have you done right without love? That's the question. What have you done right without having love? The foundation of the gospel, love and forgiveness. That reminds me of that woman who was dying of that sickness. We don't want to mention them, but this is a real story.
Yes.
From one African country. And God, in his mercy, saw that her problem was unforgiveness and sent somebody to go and tell her to forgive. While she was on the sick bed, the person came right there and said, "Sister, I've come to you. There's somebody you are holding grudge against who has wronged you. If only you can forgive that person now, your sickness will go. I'll pray for you." She looked at the pastor or the man of God and said, "Yes, I know whom you are talking about. She wronged me. As for this one she did to me, I've forgiven her. But this particular thing she did to me," immediately she shook her head and said, she gave up the ghost straight away and died. Where would that person be today? Just because of hatred for what somebody has done, the God of love came to her and said, "This is what is holding you. Forgive and come back to heaven." She lost her soul because she did not forgive the person. And Jesus sent the pastor to her. Immediately she breathed her last and she was gone. So this is what we are saying, that you should know these things. Millions of people are sick today because of this unforgiveness, whether they are believers or unbelievers. Once you register unforgiveness in your heart, you're not operating on love, it is difficult to be healed. And that's why we're bringing this gospel to you today, that Christ is about love, and you need to forgive your brother and sister who has wronged you. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Man of God, please, can any man love God without loving his fellow human being?
We have seen people claiming that they love God by the things they do. Maybe build a church building and they give to charity. And I've seen somebody say he was in spiritism and they say he should make sure he give to charity. But he's in occultism. They see that one as love. Mm. Okay? But that is not love. Look at what the scripture says in the book of 1 John, chapter 4, verse 12. Say, "No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us." Verse 13 says, "Whereby know we that we dwell in him and he in us, because he hath given us of his spirit." And verse 14 says, "And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever therefore shall confess Jesus Christ as Lord will be saved." What the Bible is saying there is from the verse 12. So how can you say you love man? You love God. and you hate your fellow human being. And so religions are doing that today. Apart from there, some religions doing that, killing people, say they're doing it for God, loving God. You see people also claiming they love God by going to church, doing all these things. In 5 a.m., they are in service, but their husband is sick at home, and they abandon him. They don't even want to give him food. Their wife is sick of one sickness or the other. They abandon their wife and go their way, even go and change whatever they have together, wishing she would die. That is not love. And sometimes they even take the money and give to church. You are doing that outwardly. But deep down your heart, you don't love the next person beside you. So there's no way anybody can claim that he loves God without loving his fellow human being. And that's when God comes to point at us and said, no, go away from me. You are a worker of iniquity because you don't love human beings. There's no way you can claim you love me. So no man can claim he or she loves God without loving his fellow human being. So if you are right now, you and your wife have fallen apart, and what is registered in your heart is deep hatred. Your wife, out of hatred, is going to one church. You're going to another. Not that you people decided on a good arrangement to find where is convenient for you. That is okay, we see it happening. But you have deep hatred within yourself, and you can't find yourself sitting in one place, not in the same church. Your wife sleeps upstairs, you sleep downstairs due to hatred. Please, we are encouraging you to make a U-turn. You may be running this Christian race in vain, living that way. God does not operate that way. You can't pray to a loving God and hate your wife, or hate your husband, hate your son. Unforgiveness registering, and you say you love God. It is not that way. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Let love reign in your life wherever you go. So if this is your struggle right now, I want to pray with you and ask God to release that spirit of love in you. If you can forgive somebody today, your sickness will go. I'm speaking to somebody listening. If you can forgive somebody today, the sickness in you will disappear. The cancer will die. The diabetes will go. If you can forgive somebody today, your hypertension will stop. If you can forgive somebody today and call God, God will take away that HIV you are going through. You must forgive. Even the person through whom you were infected, forgive them. Be open. And God will heal you of every sickness. Can you pray with us right now? Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I come to you as a sinner. I ask you to forgive me all my sins. I have done wrong. I open the door of my heart. I ask you, Lord, to come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior. I confess you died for me on the cross of Calvary, and I believe God raised you from the dead. Thank you, Holy Jesus, for forgiving me all my sins. From now onwards, I ask you to give me your love, that I'll be able to forgive everyone who has wronged me. And Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you heal me of this sickness right now. By adventure, that is the problem. As I call them and ask them, I've forgiven them. Lord, I want to thank you for my healing. Blessed be thy name. I receive the gospel by faith. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen.